So we will start with the next building services, that is the lighting in a building. Now, which is or lighting is one of the very basic and the essential component that must be provided in a building for the occupants. Now, this picture clearly indicates or shows the two different views from the lighting point of view that can be clearly identified, that both the spaces are well lighted, but where the difference lies. So one can say that in a one space in a picture takes the maximum advantage of the daylight, and other space in a second picture uses the artificial lighting system. So here comes the lighting, that is essential building service. It classify into two main subcategories or two types. First one is a natural lighting, or it is also called as a daylighting, and second one is a artificial lighting that can be or that must be integrated with the daylighting system in any building. So natural light and the daylight is available during the daytime, and the artificial light we have to use during the cloudy days, and during the night time also we have to use the artificial light. We will discuss with the natural lighting, or it is also called as a daylighting. Now this newly era or new world, we are more concerned about the carbon emissions or the carbon footprint of the building, that must be a less one, that must be lower one. We should take a measure to reduce the carbon emission from the building, which is responsible for the global warming. And for that we have an option, that or we have a one thing that must be used, that is a sustainable design of the building, so that a building become an environmental friendly building which provides or which emit less carbon. So the planned use of natural light in the residential and the non-residential building has become an important strategy to improve the energy efficiency by minimizing lighting, heating and the cooling load of the building. And the introduction of the innovative advanced daylighting strategies and the systems can considerably reduces the electricity consumption and also significantly improves the quality of the light of an indoor environment. When we called it as a good indoor environment, that is a good indoor building environment, when we are going to provide a more comfort to the occupants or to the human being that are going to use the build. So here there is a list of the benefits of the daylight. So first one is the daylighting in a building is a key strategy for the passive design. The daylight improves the people comfort and the productivity. No doubt, when the comfort is increased, the productivity is also going to be increased. When we are talking from the commercial building point of view, the electrical lighting accounts for 35% to 50% of the total electrical energy consumption. So the strategic use of the daylighting can reduce this energy demand. Strategic use means when we are going to maximize the use of daylighting, so that can be reduces the energy demand. Even when we can't use the daylight, a good lighting design can reduce the energy use significantly, and both are important in a net zero energy buildings. So when we are designing a building, planning the building from the daylighting point of view, it is essential to know the different components of the daylight. So before that, what is exactly mean by daylight, that we will see first. So daylight is obviously a controlled admission of the natural light, sunlight and the diffused skylight into the building to reduce the electrical lighting and saving of the energy. So that daylighting system we are providing, in that we have to take a control over the admission of the natural light. The components of the daylighting is designed in such a way that the electrical lights can be dimmed off or they are totally turned off for the majority portion of the day or the working hours of the day, there should not be any requirement of the artificial light. So that is the ideal daylighting system, where we have to turn off the entire lighting system or the artificial lighting system during the maximum portion of the day, while preventing the occupant discomfort and other building load from the increasing. At the same time, we have to think from the occupant comfort point of view and the other loads from the increasing. So, understanding of the daylight component is important for designing of apertures and the selection of the material. So, this part comes into the integrated principles of the daylighting designing or the planning of the building. So, there are three major daylighting components, and they are classified into: first one is a sky component, second one is the externally reflected component, and third one is internally reflected component. Internally reflected component again is subdivided into two points, that is IRC1, it is called as a reflected skylight, and IRC2, that is a reflected ground light. So what is meant by the sky component? So it is the portion of total daylight illuminance at a point received directly from the area of the sky visible through an aperture or visible through an window or visible through an any opening that is provided in the building. So second one is an externally reflected component. This represents the light reflected from the exterior obstruction onto the point under consideration. So when we are getting a light or the solar illumination or the sun illumination from the sun, so there are number of reflectants are available, or they are located outside the building from where the reflected light gets enter into the point that we are going to take into under consideration, and this does not include any ground reflected light. Internally reflected components, this represents the light reflected from interior surfaces such as the walls, floors and the ceilings. What is meant by direct solar illuminance and the sky illuminance? So according to the National Building Code, the light received by the earth from the sun consists of a direct solar illuminance and the sky illuminance. For the purpose of daylight design only, the sky illuminance is considered. Solar illuminance is not considered for the daylight design, as the sky illuminance is available entire day. So that must be considered, and solar illuminance is available at a very short timing or very short period of the day. So that is not considered. The relative amount of the sky illuminance obviously depends on the position of the sun, that is defined by its altitude, and also it depends on the latitude of the place also. These two criteria must be considered, or they are responsible for the amount of the sky illuminance that we are getting for the daylight design purpose. Now, the external available sky illuminance values, which are expressed in a lux and which are exceeds about 90% of the daytime working hours, they may be taken as a outdoor design illuminance for ensuring the adequacy of the design. Here, some recommended values of the illuminance are given for various climatic conditions, such as 6800 lux, that is for the cold climate, 8000 lux for the composite climate, 9000 lux for a temperate climate, and 1,05,000 lux for hot and the dry climate. So here, a daylight factor is a very important thing that must be known at the time of daylighting designing. So, daylight factor is the ratio of internal illuminance level to the external illuminance level, which is given by a short form DF is equal to EI or E suffix I divided by E suffix O multiplied by 100. It is always expressed in a percentage. Now, here some recommended values of the daylight factor are given. See, the requirement of daylight factor or the recommended these values are different for various purposes or various functional requirement of the building. They are vary. The daylight factor is going to be vary. Such as kitchen requires 2%, living room requires only 1%, and the bedroom requires only the 0.5%. School requires 2% of the daylight factor, hospitals 1%, offices requires 1 to 2%. Whereas for the laboratories, factories and the art galleries, the daylight factor is much more as compared to the office, hospital and the residential building, as where the very much clarity in a light is required for a laboratories. So it will be more, 6%. For the factories also it is more, that is 5%. For the art galleries also it is 6%. So depending on the functional requirement, these are the recommended daylight factors. Now the daylight planning must be there, and it is considered in a 4 stages of the building. At every stage we can take care or we can consider the daylight factor to improve the daylight designing in the building and to reduce the energy load on the building, and the electric bill can be reduced if we focused on all these 4 phases of the building. So what are that? So first phase is a conceptual design phase of the building. Here, as the building scheme is being created, daylight design influences and is influenced by the basic decisions such as the building shapes, the proportion of various elements of the building, the form of the building, orientation of the building and the apertures, as well as about the integration and the role of building system must be considered at the conceptual design phase only. If we take the maximum effort here in this phase, we will be automatically improves the daylighting system in a building. Second phase is a design phase. As the building design evolves, the daylighting strategies must be developed for the different parts of the building. The design of facades and the interior finishing of the building and the selection of integration of the system and the services, including the artificial lighting, are related to the building daylighting plan. Third phase is a final and the construction planning stage. The selection of material and the product is affected by the daylighting strategy. So it is very important, the selection of the material from the daylighting point of view, we have to choose it. And the final details of the daylighting schemes must be worked out when the construction plans are created. So last phase is a commissioning and the post-occupancy phase. Once the building is totally constructed, the lighting control must be calibrated and ongoing operations and maintenance of the system begins. So if we take the maximum effort in a 3 previous phases of the building, we have to take a minimized effort at the post-occupancy phase. So here, now we have to think from the integration of all the things to provide a good natural system, natural lighting system in a building. So here is the list how we have to integrate all the points or all the things. They are daylight optimized building footprints, climate responsive windows to the wall area ratios must be considered. Then high performance glazing must be chosen for various openings of the buildings. Then daylight optimized fenestration design must be there. Skylights should be provided according to the need or when, as and when they are required. They may be passive one or they may be active one. Daylight redirection devices, they are also required in a building. Solar shading devices can be provided in a building. And daylight optimized interior design means the interior design also must be from the daylighting point of view. So what that includes, such as a space planning must be there, room surface finishes must be chosen according to the daylight, and furniture designing. So there are some basic principles to achieve the effective natural lighting in a building. So they are There are six principles. First one is the orientation of the building. Then the form of the building. Then the glazing ratio and the specifications of the glazings. Then window height and the location. Then overhead daylighting and daylight redirection devices. So we will see one by one how that principles can be implemented to achieve a good natural lighting in a building. So first one is the orientation of the building. So orientation of the building can be south, north, it can be east, west, but from the majority or for the ideally the orient majority of the glazing north, south with a maximum exposure to the more easily controllable daylight. South is desirable because direct solar radiation received by the south facade is easier to control. And it also prevents the excess solar gain. This excess solar gain is responsible for the unnecessary heating of the building. So we have to prevent that excess solar gain and we have to optimize the daylighting. And the light that is received from the south facade is always a relatively uniform light. As we know, north light is a best daylight because that north light is always a glare-free light, that is not a direct light, and it is a constant diffuse skylight. So from the towards east and west orientation, the sun is very low and it is almost horizontal and it is hard to control. So second one is a building form. Here building form is nothing but the shape of the building or what we call it as the envelope of the building. So long and narrow footprints are always better than the square one to access the daylight. Buildings can be arranged in a series of wings to minimize the land requirements and still we are allowing the maximum access to the daylight. The space between the two wings should not be too narrow that they shadow one another. This is a very important aspect that we have to consider from the daylight point of view, the positioning of the two buildings. What should be the distance in between two buildings so that they should not shadow one another. So although the square buildings are lower heating loads, the interior cooling load requires a complex HVAC system. So the building form or the layout or the shapes of the building or the envelope of the building can be ideally of H shape, E shape, U shape, or one can choose a rectangular shape also. These are good from the daylighting point of view. Here with these shapes we can take the maximum advantage of the daylight and we can minimize the energy requirement of the building through the use of natural light. Now, third principle of the daylighting system is a glazing ratio and the specification. So what is meant by the glazing ratio? It is nothing but the ratio of area of glazing to the area of external wall. So it may lies in between 25% to 50%. More the glazing ratio, more will be the daylight that is allowed to enter into the building, but at the same time it will create a solar heat gain also, that is higher side. Optimum glazing ratio depends on the user requirement, orientation of the building, location and view of the sky. Triple glazing, tinted or the reflective glasses can reduce the daylight, but they can increase the thermal comfort. So fourth point that we are going to discuss about the window height and the location. So this is a very important criteria that on which the daylight is depends. So NBC, that is a National Building Code, provides us a clear guidelines for the positioning of the window, for the window sill levels and for the area of the window, the head of the window. All these things are given in National Building Codes. These requirements or the window heights, window sill level, the location, they are different for the different types of building, that is residential or non-residential. So as a general rule, higher the window head height, deeper and deeper will be the penetration of the daylight into the space. Therefore, a good daylight fenestration practice dictates that the window should ideally compose of two distinct components, a daylight window and a view window. So next one is a overhead daylighting. So what is this? Overhead daylighting is nothing but a skylights that can be provided in a building as per the requirements. When the generally the skylights are provided in that type of the building where the ceiling level or the floor to floor height is more than the ideal level, so that the required light can come through those skylights near the ceiling level. So these skylights can be operated, or they can be of either passive or they may be active one. So majority of the skylights are passive because they have a very clear and diffuse medium using acrylics are used that simply allows the penetration of the daylight without the glare, and they are often compromised of double layered material for increased insulation purpose. They are provided with the double layered materials. So the next one is a daylight redirection. So how the daylight redirection can be done? So this can be done using the various devices which can redirect the direct beam sunlight and redirect it again generally onto the ceiling of the space. These devices generally consist of a large horizontal element, or it is called as a lowered system, and a vertical redirection device. They are often called as a light shelves. In both ways these devices can be used. According to the choice we can choose any one of them. So these device serves the two functions. One is a glare control, where the direct sun is redirected from the eyes of the occupants. That is very important. The light that is coming through these devices must be a glare free light, which will not create any discomfort to the eyes of the occupants. And second thing that is used, that is a daylight penetration, where the light is distributed deeper into the space. So this is a very important thing, that the daylight for which the daylight redirection devices are provided, that must be the penetration of the light deeper into the space, otherwise it is not possible. So all these six principles must be considered at the time of natural or the daylighting design of the building, which can be implemented at any stage, or which can be, we can do the best combination of these things to improve the daylighting system in a building. We can also use the integrated approach also to increase the daylighting in a building, that we have discussed thoroughly in this lecture. Thank you so much.